Hello guys, welcome to my channel Akshay Bhandari's Dental Videos. Today we'll be discussing about anatomy of temporomandibular joint. First of all, what type of joint is a temporomandibular joint? So temporomandibular joint is a bilateral joint because it is present on either side of the body and both side works in synchronization. Secondly, it is synovial joint because it consists of synovial fluid. Thirdly, it is ganglimoid joint because the joint permits sliding movements. It is also a diarthroidal joint because the joint permits rotatory movements around the two axes. First axis is the hinge axis, whereas second axis is the axis which passes through the lingula of the mandible after translation. Next, it is also a compound joint. Compound joint is the joint which comprises of three bones. So in this case, in temporomandibular joint, there is a temporal bone, a condyle, and an articular disc. But an articular disc in this case is a non-ossified bone. Hence, the temporomandibular joint is also called as a pseudo-compound joint. Ganglimoid and diarthroidal together are called as ganglimoarthroidal joint. So combining all this, we can conclude that temporomandibular joint is a bilateral, synovial, ganglimoarthroidal and compound type of joint. Moving on to morphology and parts of the joint. Temporomandibular joint consists of mandibular condyle, glenoid fossa, which is present in the squamous part of the temporal bone, articular disc, which is present between the mandibular condyle and the glenoid fossa. This articular joint, it divides the joint cavity into two parts. The part which is above the articular disc and below the glenoid fossa is called as superior joint cavity with the volume of 1.9 mm. And the part which is present between the articular disc and the mandibular condyle is called as inferior joint cavity with the volume of 0.9 mm. Superior joint cavity permits arthroidal or gliding type of movement, whereas inferior joint cavity, it provides ganglimus or hinge type of movement. There is an articular eminence which is present ahead of the glenoid fossa. Moving on to glenoid fossa, it is the shallow oval depression in infratemporal area, and the most deepest part of the fossa has extremely thin type of bone. Behind the glenoid fossa, there is an external acoustic meatus which is separated from the glenoid fossa with the help of the thin tympanic bone. Glenoid fossa anteriorly is bounded by an articular eminence. Through the glenoid fossa, there runs a petrotympanic fissure. Through this petrotympanic fissure, cauda tympani nerve exits. There is a thin posterior wall which is present behind the glenoid fossa, and it separates it from the external acoustic meatus. So glenoid fossa, as we know, that temporal bone consists of two parts, squamous part and petrous part. So similarly, glenoid fossa occupies squamous temporal bone, as well as glenoid fossa also occupies petrous temporal bone. Among these two, squamous temporal bone consists of an articular part, hence it is smooth and is covered with thick periosteum. Whereas petrous temporal bone is a non-articular part and it is in close approximation with the parotid gland, hence it is pitted. But articular part and non-articular part, their junction helps in the insertion of the joint capsule. Moving on to articular eminence, it is the lateromedial cylindrical elevation in the base of the temporal bone. Articular eminence has two slopes. The first slope is present anterior to the articular eminence, whereas the second slope is present anterior to the glenoid fossa or posterior slope of the articular eminence. Now, the second slope, which is present anterior to the glenoid fossa, is covered with fibrocartilage. Now, if we take a sagittal cross section of the articular eminence, it looks like a sigmoid curvature, as we can see in the figure. Whereas in coronal cross section, it seems to be concave mediolaterally. Moving on to the third part, mandibular condyle. So mandibular condyle, it is found on the posterior of the two processes that project upward on the ramus of the mandible. So basically, mandibular condyle is oval articular head like a rugby ball. It has a medial pole which provides an attachment to the medial discal ligament of temporomandibular joint, whereas it has a lateral pole which helps in the attachment to lateral discal ligament of temporomandibular joint. As we can see in the lower left figure, lateral pole, it is always lower than the medial pole. Lateromedially, condyle is around 13 millimeters, whereas anteroposteriorly it is around 8 millimeters. Observing the lower right figure, this is the position of the condyle, which is covered by the secondary hyaline cartilage. It is composed of almost 6 layers: superficial layer, proliferative layer, cellular and cartilaginous layers, mature cartilaginous layers, bone and bone marrow. Next, we move on to articular disc. So articular disc has around 5 zones. First zone is an anterior extension. This anterior extension, it helps in the insertion of the fibers from the tendon of lateral pterygoid muscle, whereas it connects the anterior thick band of the capsule. Moving on to next, there is an anterior band. It is moderately thickened, but it is narrow anteroposteriorly. Next, we have intermediate band. It is the area over which the articular surface of the condyle and slope of the articular eminence approximate. It gives more flexibility to the disc and it enables it to alter the shape during the movements. Next, we have posterior band. It is the most thickest and widest portion of the articular disc. And lastly, we have bilaminar zone. It is called as bilaminar zone because it has two fibrous lamina projecting from it. One is the temporodiscal band, which consists of elastic fibers, whereas another is mandibulodiscal band, which consists of collagen fibers, and it gets attached at the neck of the condyle. Next, TMJ capsule. So TMJ capsule is something which encloses the entire temporomandibular joint. So it is lined by a highly vascular synovial membrane, which helps in the lubrication of the joint. It has various sensory receptors, including nociceptors. Its attachments are: superiorly, it is attached to temporal articular surfaces. Inferiorly, it is attached to condylar neck. Medially, it blends with medial collateral ligament. Laterally, it blends with lateral collateral ligament. Anteriorly, it blends with superior head of lateral pterygoid muscle, whereas posteriorly, it runs along the retrodiscal pad. Moving on to ligaments of temporomandibular joint. So temporomandibular joint has two types of ligaments: functional ligaments and accessory ligaments. Functional ligaments are of further three types: collateral ligaments or discal ligaments, temporomandibular or lateral ligament, and capsular ligament. Whereas accessory ligaments are of two types: sphenomandibular ligament and stylomandibular ligament. Ligaments are of two types: lateral discal ligament and medial discal ligament. So correspondingly, they get attached to lateral discal ligament gets attached to lateral pole of condyle, whereas medial discal ligaments attaches to medial pole of the condyle.
as shown in the figure. In the figure we can see LDL, which is lateral discal ligament, which is connected to lateral pole of the condyle, whereas MDL, which is medial discal ligament, which attaches to the medial pole of the condyle. They are composed of collagenous connective tissue fibers, hence they are known as true ligaments of temporomandibular joint. They possess vascular supply and are innervated. Their function is to restrict the movement of the disc away from the condyle. As the discal ligaments, we can see in the figure, they are strictly adhered between the disc and the condyle. So, these ligaments does not allow the separation of the disc from the condyle. Hence, they restrict the movement of the disc away from the condyle. And they also permit the hinging movement of the temporomandibular joint. Next is the temporomandibular joint ligament or lateral ligament. So basically this ligament has two parts or two portions. First is outer oblique ligament. Second is inner horizontal ligament. Origin for both the ligaments is same, that is zygomatic process and articular tubercle. Whereas insertion, the outer oblique ligament, it attaches to the condylar neck, whereas the inner horizontal ligament, it attaches to the lateral pole of the condyle and articular disc. Function for the outer oblique ligament is, it prevents the excessive dropping of the condyle by limiting the extent of the mouth opening. So, whenever we open our jaw, this outer oblique ligament, it prevents the excessive opening of the jaw. Whereas the function of the inner horizontal ligament, it limits the posterior movement of the condyle and disc, and it prevents the condyle from moving more in the posterior region. Moving on to capsular ligament, it encloses the entire temporomandibular joint. Its functions are, it resists medial, lateral or inferior forces that tend to separate or dislocate the articular surfaces. It helps in retaining the synovial fluid, as the capsular ligament from within, it is lined by the synovial membrane. So it helps in the lubrication of the joint. The capsular ligament is well innervated. As it is well innervated, it helps in the to provide the proprioceptive feedback to the joint. As we can see in the figure, the way capsular ligament encloses the temporomandibular joint. Moving on to accessory ligaments, we have two types of accessory ligament, stylomandibular ligament and sphenomandibular ligament. So stylomandibular ligament, as the name suggests, it extends from the styloid process to the posterior margin of the angle of the mandible and the ramus of the mandible. Whereas sphenomandibular ligament, it is the remnant of the Meckel's cartilage and it extends from the spine of the sphenoid bone to the lingula of the mandible. Both of them usually helps in limiting the anterior protrusion of the mandible. Coming on to blood supply and nerve supply of the temporomandibular joint, arterial supply is with the help of superficial temporal artery and maxillary artery branches, whereas venous supply is with the help of superficial temporal vein and maxillary vein. Nerve supply is with the help of auricular temporal nerve and masseteric branches of mandibular nerve. Hope you liked the video. For more such videos, please like, share and subscribe my channel Akshay Bhandari's Dental Videos. See you soon. Thank you.